Okay, I think we're going to get this thing going. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the May edition of our science communication webinar. As usual, we're going to ask that you keep your cameras off and your mic muted. And as you have questions, go ahead and drop those in the chat and I'll be monitoring that. I'll make sure we ask Fallon our questions at the end of her presentation. And so today we're going to have Fallon Owens, our Extension Wildlife Biologist, and she's going to be presenting on the North Carolina Wildlife Helpline, the science of helping people and wildlife coexist. So Fallon, take it away.
Okay, thank you, Heather. I'm gonna pop my camera on really quick just to say hello, everybody. And then I'm going to turn it off so that I won't be distracting while I give this presentation. And hopefully you'll be looking at all the amazing pictures and data that I'll be showing you. So farewell for now. I'll turn it back on when we go into the Q&A portion. So I'm going to talk about the Wildlife Helpline. I'm really excited about it. And before I talk about really anything else, though, I'm going to get started with where kind of it all starts with our agency, our mission. So here's our mission for all of our agency staff. We should be familiar with it. When the public see this, you know, this might be new to them, but it is to conserve North Carolina's wildlife resources and their habitats and provide programs and opportunities that allow hunters, anglers, boaters, and other outdoor enthusiasts to enjoy wildlife-associated recreation. And just to distill that down a bit, we've got some key words. Basically, our job is to conserve wildlife and habitats and provide opportunities that allow hunters, anglers, boaters, and other outdoor enthusiasts to enjoy that outdoor wildlife-associated recreation. So for our traditional constituents, our hunters, our anglers, boaters, trappers, this makes complete sense. And we employ a lot of passionate and dedicated professionals who do this work and who do it very well. But at the same time, we're seeing an increasing proportion of North Carolinians who don't choose to engage in those activities, even if they still care about nature and about wildlife. Add to this the fact that our state is experiencing an influx of new residents, often from major U.S. cities and attracted by North Carolina's relatively new reputation as the Silicon Valley of the South. So very kind of tech heavy as opposed to outdoor heavy. And these are often people who are brand new to North Carolina's wildlife and its habitats. They also bring with them expectations based on how their home states manage wildlife, which is often very different than the way we do things here in North Carolina. So what we're seeing is that increasingly, people expect us to be there and provide support when they interact with wildlife, because often it's all new to them, the species, the behaviors, what's allowed and what isn't, what resources are available to help. Faced with an unexpected wildlife encounter, now more than ever, North Carolinians expect their wildlife agency to act as first responders who are there to solve their wildlife problems or to save wild animals in need. And usually their focus is more on individual animals as opposed to populations, which is really how wildlife are managed, by state agencies. And this isn't just a trend we're seeing in North Carolina. Landmark research supports this idea that people's perspectives toward wildlife in the United States are shifting. The America's Wildlife Values Report that came out in 2018 broke down how each state's citizens felt about wildlife and how much they felt their state wildlife management agency shared their values. They were able to break down these perspectives to show that the majority of the people in the United States don't share traditional values on wildlife, which revolve around their use as a consumable resource. And these people were called the traditionalists, and that's in blue on this graph. So instead, many people see wildlife as kind of extended family or companions, and those people were termed the mutualists, and that's in green. Or they have a mix of feelings between this and the more traditional consumption-oriented view of wildlife. And those were called the pluralists in orange. And then, of course, you get the people who don't think much about wildlife at all, and they were designated distanced in gray. So that's the United States. But when we look just at the data from North Carolina, we see a similar trend. And that is that most people overall fall into this mutualist and pluralist category, or this distance category. And the traditionalist view is only about 30% of the population. And that North Carolina survey also found that about 59% of North Carolinians believe that they share the same wildlife values as the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission. And that's really not bad, especially compared to some of the other states. But it also means that more than one in three residents in North Carolina don't believe we share their values when it comes to wildlife. So our agency is working really hard on this currently. It's one of the reasons why you see us getting involved with Watchable Wildlife and other efforts that help us stay relevant to the people that we serve. But my point here is to show that there exists a gap between our traditional role as a state wildlife agency and the services people increasingly expect us to provide. Among state wildlife agencies around the country, this idea of relevancy is a major concern and has been for several years now. Leaders in wildlife conservation recommend that state agencies be more transparent, more accessible, and provide quality information proactively. And that's that right pillar of trust there on the slide. This is from a presentation that was given at the Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies last year in 2022. So how does the Wildlife Resources Commission accomplish this? We are a relatively small state agency with limited capacity to be everywhere at once. And it's really not our job to be everything that people expect us to be. There are practical limits to what we can feasibly do as an agency. But we can meet people where they are and provide a resource that is flexible, knowledgeable, and able to track what people are experiencing and what help they're asking us to provide. And so the North Carolina Wildlife Helpline was created as part of an effort to do this. It's kind of like a 411 information center for wildlife questions, especially for what we call human-wildlife interactions, or HWIs. It's reachable by phone or email during normal business hours, so 8 a.m. To 5 p.m. Monday through Friday by phone or email. And it's been around for about 6 years now. It got started in April 2017. Here's the original inaugural helpline crew. And that was two full-time biologists and one temp. You can see me in the picture there. I was one of the first helpline biologists. And today, the helpline is run with three full-time biologists, with a fourth full-time biologist starting next week, just to keep up with the demand. This time of year, they're handling back-to-back calls and helping people through all manner of issues, from bats in the attic to bears in the bird feeder to baby rabbits the dog brought in, and so much more. These guys are heroes. If you ever come to the headquarters and you have a few moments, go to the second floor to the back in the customer service section and tell them hi and shake their hands, because they do a lot of hard work. So, but what exactly do they do when they're working on the helpline? They can't really act as a dispatch service in most cases, despite common expectations to the contrary, but they can and do listen. Their job is to hear people's issues and offer tailored solutions that are evidence-based, legal, and effective. Once they've listened, they'll provide information about the situation, the biology and the behavior of the animal involved, any pertinent rules and regulations. If the situation calls for it, they might recommend lethal removal of the animal, but often the conversation is about teaching coexistence when feasible. Their goal is to promote long-term solutions instead of quick fixes that don't really solve the underlying problem. For example, asking this person to remove the pet food that's attracting the raccoons onto the porch in the first place, instead of recommend trapping and physically removing the raccoon. And not only does this help conserve wildlife through education, which is part of our mission, it's about providing excellent customer service in the long run. They give people high quality information that empowers them to solve the problem for themselves. You know, teach a man to fish and all of that. But something they also do is to track key information about those calls and emails so that we can learn from what people are experiencing, you know, what their baseline knowledge and expectations are, and what resources they find most appropriate to them. So let's take a look under the hood and see what this data really looks like. And my apologies in advance, apologies for all these charts and graphs. I'll try to keep it interesting, but this is supposed to be a research talk. So there you go, it's not my fault. So here are the calls that the Wildlife Helpline took for each month in 2022. And by the way, these guys handled over 24,000 calls last year. You'll see that during the summer months, that's when they receive the most calls, mostly because wildlife are active and they're busy raising young and the weather is nice. So people are outside more and coming across wildlife more often. We can also look at the general types of calls that people are making. Were they complaining about a nuisance situation? That's in orange. Were they concerned for a wild animal in need? That's the line in blue. Were they just reporting a sighting of something of interest? That's down at the bottom in green. Not quite as many as of those. We can also take a look at what species people are contacting us about. So last year was a banner year for deer calls. It's right at the top there. And that's because this was the first year, or last year was the first year that North Carolina detected chronic wasting disease in our state. So we were doing a lot of communication and outreach with the public to educate them about this disease. And as a result, we got a lot of calls from people asking questions and wondering, you know, is this deer in my yard sick or should I be concerned? You know, what are the risks to me? So we can see that bear out in the data. And you'll also notice some other sort of common species that we get a lot of calls about that people are needing help with. Black bears, songbirds, that's a lot of fledglings on the ground and birds striking windows and things like that. Squirrels, raccoons, foxes, coyotes, these are kind of the top list of the wildlife that people encounter, that they need help to encounter responsibly. So they contact us about it. A little bit more about the sort of internal helpline data. You know, we can actually look and see what happens when people call. What are the outcomes of those calls? And, you know, how are they resolved? So, for example, 34% last year of the calls that came into the helpline were resolved just over the phone. You know, our helpline biologists answered the questions and the people felt like they, you know, had what they needed and the situation was considered resolved. But over half of the calls ended up going to external referrals. So somebody outside of our agency who was more appropriate to sort of directly get involved in a situation. And then we can break that down and we see that out of all the calls that ended up being referred externally to people outside of our agency, about half of those went to wildlife rehabilitators. And then about a quarter went to licensed wildlife control agents. So these are kind of the boots on the ground individuals who are doing a lot of this wildlife work, the on the ground sort of first responder work that a lot of people are expecting. And by the way, if you're not aware, contacts for all the licensed wildlife rehabilitators, wildlife control agents, and a whole bunch of other these professionals are available on our website at ncwildlife.org/haveaproblem. So we try to make that information available to the public so that they can get those resources when they need. But they can also just call the helpline and we'll tell them, you know, who they can call. Another example of the helpline data. So, you know, we try to ask every person who contacts us what county they're in, at the very least. We try not to be too nosy and ask a bunch of personal questions, because if it's not needed to help resolve the issue, you know, we don't want to ask more than we need. But we do try to get at least the county that they're located in. And with that, we can construct these really cool maps about where people are experiencing certain types of wildlife issues in the state. For example, last year, this is the vulture reports in North Carolina for last year. We are we're experiencing an ongoing outbreak of avian influenza in North Carolina and pretty much the rest of the United States. So this map partly reflects where those calls were coming from about sick or dead vultures. It hit really hard in the Carr Reservoir area around Wake County, et cetera. And so in part, this map kind of tells the story of that avian influenza outbreak that we were experiencing last year and that we sort of, to some extent, still experience. Okay, so that's kind of the raw data, but excuse me, let me grab some water. Okay. So data for data's sake can be really neat, but you know, the kind of the whole point of this talk is to show how we are using this information to be better informed of people's needs and more efficiently and proactively communicate how they can respond to wildlife encounters and prevent conflicts. And this is really the good part of the talk, so bear with me. One of the ways we do this is to use the data to create timely, relevant press releases to let people know when they're likely to experience certain types of wildlife encounters. For example, we knew from the seasonal data that every year there's a spike in coyote sightings around late October and early November, right around when the juvenile coyotes are dispersing from their parents' territories. So we put out a press release tying in the howling of coyotes with Halloween. And it was one of our most successful and well-picked up press releases about coyotes because we were able to use the data to make the information interesting and relevant to the people that we were really trying to reach. Another example, we know that gray squirrels nest twice a year, and we regularly see calls about baby squirrels found on the ground during the nesting season, or the two seasons. But with the data, we were able to see these obvious spikes in calls after particularly heavy summer storms or even hurricanes. So we wrote up a press release about how summer storms can make it more likely for people to spot a baby squirrel on the ground and what to do if they find one. We decided to hold on to this release until right after a big storm came through, and it took off like fire. Multiple media outlets picked it up. You can see this one from USA Today, because we put this information out and we were communicating this message at just the right moment when people most needed to hear it and when they were most interested in paying attention to this information. Here's another example, but slightly different. Not only can we use the data to sculpt important messages via our communication channels, like our press releases, we can also use it to answer questions that we receive from journalists or legislators or members of the public about what's going on with wildlife encounters whenever we get those questions. So, for example, this past March, a local news station, WLOS and ABC 13 News, they decided to spend a whole week highlighting stories about bear encounters in the Asheville area. They called it Bear Week. And on their request, we were able to provide statistics on how many calls we receive about bears from Buncombe County over the last several years. And then along with that, share our recommendations on how people can be bear wise. We can also provide targeted outreach to specific areas that are encountering certain issues, such as this next door post to Weaverville residents when we were receiving a lot of bear complaints from that area over a short period of time. By the way, mad props to our excellent communications team who works with me and the helpline biologists to get these messages out when they can have the biggest impact. Okay, just a few more examples. Here's where some of the data that's being that we have is being used in presentations to help educate new coastal residents and visitors about alligators and where people are likely to encounter them. So the data helps support our education efforts by backing up our recommendations with supporting evidence. And here we see that, you know, we're getting this influx of people moving onto the into the coast and visitors coming to visit the coastal areas. And we see that bearing out in the data that as we get more people in these areas, we get more calls about alligators. And this shows us there's a bigger need for education and giving people common sense tips to coexist with alligators. And by the way, if you think the best way to solve problems with alligators is to remove them from the area, here's the number of calls we receive about alligators each year. Those are the blue bars. And the proportion of those calls that were resolved by removing the alligator, that's in orange and gray. So you can kind of see just educating people solves a lot of problems. And having good data to support that makes our job easier. Okay, just a couple more. These are more about our scientific understanding of the wildlife that we conserve. Hellbenders, eastern hellbenders, are one of those species that we take special efforts to monitor because they're one of our listed species and their habitat requirements are so specific. And also they're just really, really cool. But reports from the public that are taken by the Wildlife Helpline help us keep track of where their current range is and helps guide our conservation efforts for the species. So this map that you're looking at in part is created through reports from the public that come through the Wildlife Helpline. The people on the ground can see a lot more hellbenders than our researchers can doing surveys. And together, those two groups of data really are much more powerful than any one group can do alone. And just one more, very similarly, recent reports of chipmunks seen way outside of their known range, way down in the Wilmington area, kind of spurred on an effort to ask the public, like, okay, somebody's reporting that there are chipmunks where we didn't think there were chipmunks, so we need you to tell us where there are chipmunks. And this is ongoing. We're still collecting the data and looking at the data so that we can update these maps. But basically, we're going to learn about the species and where it is by the virtue of the fact that people are seeing them that are not biologists with the commission, and their input is incredibly valuable. So, all told, there's a lot of power in just being available to listen to people's concerns and to meet them where they are. There's a lot of expertise and knowledge that we as an agency have to offer, but we also have a lot to learn from the people of North Carolina. And that's not something new, we just have, you know, even better tools to do that these days. So, you know, it's those people, in fact, who are the ones that are out there living and hopefully learning to coexist with wildlife. So their input is part of how we are effective as an agency. And that's pretty much what I've got. So I went through that a lot faster than I thought I was going to. And I guess I can turn on my camera and we can see if anybody has any questions.
Okay, thank you, Fallon. That was great information to have. So yeah, if anybody has a question, go ahead and drop that in the chat. I am looking at it, so I'm ready to read that out. And while we're waiting, I'll have a question. So you mentioned at one point that the Wildlife Help Hotline is, you know, normal business operating hours, 9 to 5. So what do we recommend the public to do outside of those operating hours?
Yeah, so we do try to put a lot of information on our website. Depending on who you are, you might want to go to the website first before calling somebody. But, you know, even if the helpline isn't available outside of business hours, that the information on where you can find a rehabilitator who's in your area, what wildlife control agent works in your county, you know, that information is still all available on the internet. And so outside of business hours, we do have an enforcement telecommunications office that can take those calls, but their priority is mostly you know, dealing with emergency situations involving wildlife violations, like violations of the law. So really, if it's a non-emergency issue, we do prefer that people give us a call during our business hours, because our helpline biologists, I mean, that's what they do. They help people with wildlife encounters. So outside of that, definitely checking out the website and or even giving us an email. We have an email address, and that's a great way to just get the question to us, and then we'll respond when the biologists are you know, back in the office.
Great. I had one other question as I was listening to you. So for these calls that we're taking in that are contributing to our understanding of species range, what do we consider a valid observation? Is it, I'm assuming if someone just calls in and says, hey, I saw this, that we need a little bit more information. So what kind of information do they need to send in for us to be like, yes, that was a hellbender, or no, that wasn't?
Yeah, sure. I think it's different for every species and every researcher who is responsible for sort of taking all of those reports and doing something with them. But of course, photographic evidence or actual physical evidence is always much better than just, hey, I saw a thing, and that's just verbal testimony. It can be problematic. So that's, I think most of our biologists really love to have a photograph. That's powerful, and yeah, everybody's got smartphones these days. So if you see something interesting, take a photograph of it and send it to us. And that way we can say that, oh, well, that's a really powerful observation, because we have this data that, or this evidence that's associated with it.
Okay. I'm not seeing any other questions come up in the chat. If anybody has anything, speak now. Forever hold your peace. All right. Well, thank you again. That was wonderful information. Here comes a question. What kinds of fish questions do you often get?
Oh, thank you, Casey. That's a great question. And to be completely fair and honest, we don't really get too many calls about fish, because not a lot of people have an unexpected encounter with a fish. So the helpline biologists are mostly there to help people when they have some encounter with a wild animal and they don't know what to do about it. Most of the time, people kind of sign up for their fish encounters because they're actively fishing. And that's not to say that they don't get calls about like pond management and what in the world is this weird animal I just hooked on my line. They do get those calls, but they are fairly rare. And some of our biologists are really good at answering those calls, but often they might pull in a fisheries biologist who's really going to be the better expert on that topic.
Great. Okay. Yes, we just had a question about the availability of this presentation, and a recording will be made available on our YouTube channel and the agency website, and I will send out an email when it's ready to be viewed. So barring any further questions, we'll say thanks again to Fallon. Everyone can join us next month on June 13th. We're going to have April Boggs presenting on the impacts of low head dams on fish in the Little River. And everybody have a great week.
Thank you for listening to me.